Good evening. It is a pleasure to welcome Chantal Mouffe, Professor of Political Theory at the University of Westminster. Indeed, she hardly needs an introduction because her work as political theorist has been recognized worldwide. And it really influences the way in which we analyze the question of democracy today. She's author of The Democratic Paradox and On the Political, to name but a few of her books, as well as of Hegemony and Socialist Strategy Towards a Radical Democratic Politics with Ernesto Laclau. This is her third time in Zagreb, and the title of her talk tonight is How to Interpret Recent Protest Movements, an Agonistic Approach. Chantal, the floor is yours.
It's a real pleasure to be again in Zagreb. In fact, the last time I was here was 6 years ago when I took part in the first Subversive Festival. And it's great to see that not only the festival has survived, but it also has grown. And now it is really become, it's one of the most interesting events in the whole of Europe, I will say. And it's also now encompass not only film, but discussion. So it is something which in 6 years have really become a very important event for the left. So it's really a pleasure to be here again with you. What I want to do in this presentation is to analyze, scrutinize the recent protest movement, uprising. Some people speak of revolution. I mean, it all depends, of course, on how you want to qualify those things. I want to challenge a certain interpretation of those movements and present another reading informed by my work about agonism. But I want to make clear at the outset that in no way do I want to homogenize all those very heterogeneous movements. I disagree with a certain tendency to throw together the struggle in Tunisia, Egypt, not to speak of Libya and even Syria, then put that together with the revolt in the suburb in France, the riot in Britain, the demonstration in Israel, the popular mobilization in Greece, the encampment of the indignados in Spain, the student movement in Chile, the protest in Israel, and the various forms of Occupy in the US and in Europe. So here, people who put that all together and say, oh, it's fantastic, you know, there is no this new movement of protest. Well, I think that is very problematic to homogenize all that. To be sure, in several cases, we can find similar features. For instance, the use of social networks like Facebook and microblogging sites such as Twitter. But I think that their role has often been greatly exaggerated. To speak, for instance, in the case of Tunisia and Egypt, it has been the case of a Google revolution, is clearly risible. In fact, and this has been, you know, pointed out by people in those countries, in the case of the Middle East, it seems that a crucial role has been played by television, which, contrary to the internet, is accessible to many popular sectors, either at home, and when they don't have it home, they can see television in cafes. You know, so this is something which they say much more important than the internet. But there is also a more significant commonality, which concern the spatial occupation of public places. And of course, it is no denying the influence of the model of the Tahrir Square in Cairo on, for instance, the occupation of Puerta del Sol in Madrid or Syntagma Square in Athens, and also the various Occupy camps. But the reason that brought people to those locations were very different. In the Middle East, the demonstrations were directed against dictatorial regime, while in Europe and in the US, they were mainly expression of resistances against the shortcomings of the democratic system and the subservience of this system to the forces of finances. So I think that it's important to see that those movements are the product of very specific circumstances and that their aims are different. To proclaim, as it is sometimes done, that they announce a new type of molecular politics that is bound to displace the archaic representative form, if I find highly problematic. Moreover, it leads to neglecting the specificity of their various contexts and their particular characteristics. This is not the place to undertake a careful study of all those diverse popular mobilizations. And what interests me here is rather different. I want to examine the responses of radical political theorists to those movements and the different way in which they have been interpreted. Many claims have been made on behalf of what is construed as a new type of activism moved by a universal desire for communism or the common or a real democracy. And the reaction to those mobilizations they provoke are, I think, worth scrutinizing. Why is it that they are interpreted in the direction and under what kind of theory? What theory informed this view? Since this discussion touched directly on questions that I have been addressing in my recent work, this will also give me the opportunity of testing the pertinence of my agonistic approach for grasping the specificity of the current situation. So what I want to do is precisely to explain to you how they can be envisaged from an agonistic approach and in what way it differs from another approach. Well, I'm going to leave aside the uprising in the Middle East because I think they require a different analysis. And I will concentrate on how the various mobilizations in liberal democratic societies have been interpreted. We find a broad agreement among political commentators and theorists on at least one aspect. The recent protests are not mere reaction to the current austerity measure. They reveal a profound malaise with respect to democratic institutions, whose crisis they bring to the fore. And it is with respect to the sources, the causes of such crisis, and the remedies that are needed, that opinions diverge. This is something to do with the malaise of representative democracy, I agree. But what are the reasons and what are the solutions? And there is a real disagreement. In examining those divergences, we will see that they proceed from different approaches to radical politics, either in terms of what I've called withdrawal from or engagement with, because in recent work I have argued there are at the moment two main views to envisage radical politics. One strategy, which strategy that I call withdrawal from, or the advocate of that strategy speak of an exodus. They say we need to abandon all concern with engaging with parties, trade unions, institutions. Let's have an exodus, a desertion from those institutions, and let's try to build next to that new form of organization of the common, self-organization of the multitude. And this is the way in which radical politics should be envisaged. Of course, as you see, is definitively something in which the work of Michael Hart and Antonio Negri have been important, the strategy of exodus. But not only him, Paolo Virno and John Holloway. I mean, there are many people who in different ways follow this approach. Well, to that approach, I have opposed the strategy that I call a strategy of engagement with. and say that it is, in fact, for the people who were here a few days ago, where at some point, Oliver Stone, when he spoke, say something that is go into this direction of what I call engagement with, even if I will put it a little bit differently. He say we need to join the system in order to change it. I will say we need to engage with the system, I will say, in order to change it. So it's not a question of desertion, but engaging with things in order to change it. And this is the strategy that I call a strategy of engagement with, not a strategy of desertion. Because I think it's, as we are going to see, it is really this alternative between engagement with and withdrawal from, which inform the conflicting ways of framing the reading of recent protests and of evaluating their potential. As a starting point, I think that it is necessary to distinguish within the popular mobilization that have recently taken place in liberal democratic societies between those who follow more traditional left patterns and those that diverge from them. I think, for instance, that despite undeniable contacts among them, it is, for instance, very misleading to put in the same category the Spanish indignados and the student movement in Chile. And this is something which is often done. In the Chilean case, what we have is, in fact, something nearer, I'm not saying it's the same thing, but it's thing nearer to a classical left-wing mobilization of students. Students who are fighting for a better education, they are fighting with having specific demand that they address to the state. It's a movement that is formally organized with elected leaders who do not reject party affiliation. For instance, the first one of those leaders, which is very well known, Camila Vallejo, is in fact a member of the Chilean Communist Party. And she is now, in fact, planning to run as a candidate in the national election. So very different from the position of the indignados with respect to parties, as you can see. So I think that, you know, it's very misleading. They're all the same thing. No, they've got a very different strategy. On one side, we've got a strategy of withdrawal from the indignados. In the case of the student movement in Chile, it's a strategy of what I call engagement with. But the situation is, of course, very different with the indignados in the M15, if we compare that with the strategy of the Chilean student movement, because the indignados call for, as we know, democracia realia, a real democracy now. They reject the representative democratic system in favor of real democracy. They prone assemblyism instead of parliamentarism. Insisting on remaining without leaders, they refuse to have anything to do with traditional political institutions like election, parties, or trade unions. A similar negative posture towards representative instances was found also, for instance, in the Greek version of the indignados and among the various Occupy movement. I'm not saying that, you know, all of them were exactly that, but we find in those movement sector which were really following this strategy. The Occupy movement in Europe, but also in America, I think I would not put exactly the indignados and the Occupy in the same, you know, camp, because there is something which I find more interesting with the Occupy, that contrary to the indignados, the Occupy, at least, they had an indication who is the enemy, you know. Occupy Wall Street, Occupy London Stock Exchange. So the enemy was the financial institution presented as the one person oppressing the remaining 99. I will have something to say in a moment about this slogan, which I find problematic. But at least, you know, we know who is the enemy. It's not like democracia realia. I mean, it's much more precise. What indignados and occupiers share, that's undeniable, is their rhizomatic horizontal character, the fact that they function as leaderless network, a platform without a center. At the beginning, before they were evicted, you know, from their encampment by the local authorities, their focus was on establishing camp in public square. If we move to a second phase, they are now trying to diversify their form of protest through activism in the neighborhood level with specific issues concerning debt, foreclosure, and eviction, among others. That's the second stage of those movements. But since then, an important development has taken place in some countries, for instance in Spain and particularly in Greece, where the nature of the protest has been transformed by the involvement of new constituencies. In the case of Spain, where the right-wing Partido Popular is now in power with an absolute majority, the protests have widened and they've acquired a different character. There are now massive mobilization led by the trade unions not only the trade unions, but they've managed to mobilize different sectors of the population, which manifest against the drastic austerity program of the Partido Popular, which is centered on public service privatization, administrative re-centralization, and criminalization of protest. So this is now a movement which is much wider than the Indignados, and it's a different character. And of course, this is also clear in Greece, where we find mass protests organized by the radical left party Syriza against the policies of the ruling conservative New Democracy Party. This indicates, as I will argue later, that we should not overlook the role of left parties when we discuss the future of those movements and the strategy that they should follow, and also the potential for change that those movements can bring. When those later developments are taken into account, what has happened, the development of those, the move from comes in of the Indignados to mass protests and from Syntagma Square in Greece towards the mobilization of Syriza, then I think the complex nature of the protest is brought to the fore. And I think this is why their critique of the current democratic system can be interpreted in different ways, because it's complex. We find certainly among them, I don't want to deny that at all, activists were against any form of representation altogether. No, they express a total rejection of representative democracy and yearn for a society reconciled with itself through direct democracy. The aim of other groups, however, is not to get rid of representative institutions, but to improve them, so as to make them more accountable to the citizen. Privileging the first type of critique, and the radical critique of representative democracy, many theorists, influenced by the exodus approach, have seen in recent mobilization a manifestation of the power of the multitude, constructing new form of social relation outside traditional institutions. They celebrate them as the realization of the common and present their encampments as prefiguration of the project of absolute democracy that they advocate. So this is, of course, the way in which those mobilization are seen by the people defending the exodus, and they see that as an example of their strategy. Some theorists influenced by this approach, prioritizing the exodus from existing form of democracy, have put the emphasis on the emergence of new democratic practice, often horizontalist, or sometimes it's called a presentist nature. Isabelle Laurie, for instance, who see those movements, for them they are characteristic of the new form of struggle of the precarious workers, which are of course typical of post-Fordism, and she argues that the Spanish indignados with their call for democracia realia, what they advocate, she says, is not in fact direct democracy, because direct democracy is still too much a form of representation, because it's a democracy in which all the citizens will participate. What they advocate, she says, really, is a radically different understanding of democracy, an understanding of democracy beyond representation, a democracy in actu, and she called that presentist democracy. Laurie claims that the diverse occupation movement represents a radical challenge in politics, in society, and in economics, and that they signal the emergence of constituent power beyond representation. Following the analysis of Antonio Negri, she sees the constituent power as a process that cannot be represented nor embodied in judicial institutionalized power. She insists that it must reject mediation through representation and should not be tamed into a people. Presentist democracy is, according to Laurie, the opposite of representative democracy. It is a matter of collective political practices without any claim to government. So that's a typical example of, you know, reading of this is something completely new with those movements, and they challenge profoundly a representative democracy. They call for an alternative presentist democracy. Well, the mobilization of the Occupy type, it of course received a lot of attention, and their resonance has been undeniable. But that should not make us forget that this is not the first time that citizens have assembled outside the traditional political channels to make their voice heard. As a recent study, which had been undertaken for the London School of Economics by Mary Caldor and Sabine Selshaw, remind us what they call subterranean politics has been around for some time. And they argue that what we have witnessed in 2011 and 2012 is what they call a bubbling up of subterranean politics. By that term, they refer to all types of political groups, initiatives, events, or ideas, both on the left and on the right, that are not usually visible in mainstream politics across the political spectrum. Occupy belongs to that category, of course, as do also the Wutburger protests in Germany against Stuttgart 21, the manifold of citizen intervention outside the parties, the anti-globalization demonstration, the World Social Forum, and many other civil society initiatives in a variety of domains. So for them, all those are form of what they call subterranean politics. This is also where they locate, for instance, the various pirate parties, and I must say more surprisingly, a variety of right-wing populist movements like Jobbik in Hungary and New Dawn in Greece. That I found a bit problematic, but for them it's things which are, you know, different form of politics. Caldor and Selshaw's study is centered on the emancipatory form of subterranean politics. So when they do their research, they don't go and interview, you know, Golden Dawn or Jobbik, but the more emancipatory form. And of course, they give pride of place to the indignants in Europe. Their research is based on interviews with activists, and I think it's quite useful to examine what are the answers of those activists. For instance, I've learned things that I was not expecting to find there, that many activists of Occupy are very critical of the World Social Forum, because they see it as much, still much too under the influence of the traditional left. Well, in fact, this chimes with the attitude of the indignados of the M15 and their rejection of all politicians, both right and left. The answer to the interview also betokens the great disparity in the ideological orientation of the activist. This disparity is openly recognized by the manifesto of M15, where we read, and here I quote from this manifesto, "Some of us consider ourselves progressive, others conservative. Some of us are believers, some not. Some of us have clearly defined ideologies, others are apolitical." End of quote. Well, given the such heterogeneity of view and the insistence on reaching consensus, it is therefore not surprising that when assemblies finally manage to produce some resolution through an horizontal process of decision making, they generally lack the systematic focus necessary to make some specific proposal. Indeed, some activists are against the very idea of formulating demands. The interview realized further project about subterranean politics, I think, cast doubt about the claim that the anti-representative position is typical of the majority of the activists. There is no denying, of course, that such views are found among the activists involved in those movements. And I'm willing to grant the presentist character of some of the practice developed in the camps and in the assemblies. But I think that to present the aim of all of the outrage as being the establishment of a democracy beyond representation is to read those protests in a very unilateral way. But more importantly, in my view, even if those views were dominant, well, this would not be enough to conclude that such strategy is adequate and that practice informed by horizontality and presentism should provide the backbone of the progressive struggle. The question we should ask concerns the efficacy of such practice and their potential for bringing about a different type of society. It could, in fact, be argued that the very evolution of Occupy reveals the limits of those practices, limits that have been acknowledged by the activists themselves. For instance, on 17 September 2012, just 1 year after the birth of Occupy Wall Street, Mark Greif, who had been deeply involved in this movement, wrote an article where he asserted that although it had been successful in putting the issue of equality on the agenda, Occupy had failed in most of its objectives with respect to Wall Street and its struggle against financial institutions. Greif's appreciation of the pros and cons of Occupy camp is shared by many people who have celebrated the impact of Occupy on the political discourse in the US. You know, the fact that it's not no small thing to put equality, you know, in discussion, in debate in the US. But they've also noted their lack of strategy for bringing about institutional changes. Sure, in voicing the outrage against the obscene inequalities existing in the midst of Western societies, those movements have contributed to raise important issues, and this can hopefully motivate people to call for an alternative. But this is only the beginning, and to effectively transform power relations, the new consciousness that arises out of those protests require institutional channels. To challenge neoliberalism, it is necessary to engage with these key institutions, and it is not enough to organize new form of existence of the common outside the dominant capitalist structure, as if those structures would progressively ebb away without any confrontation. Besides problem with the anti-institutional strategy of Occupy, I must say that I have also have some reservation concerning the type of discourse in which their protest is articulated. It is certainly commendable to give voice to the outrage against the financial system, but this must be done in a political way, targeting the ideological, economic, and political forces that structure this system. Otherwise, there is a real danger that the current protest will operate in the register of morality on the basis of a good-bad dichotomy. It is no doubt positive that Occupy, as I've already indicated, in contrast to the Indignados, is a clearly defined adversary. Yeah? Wall Street, the London Stock Exchange, and other financial institutions. Yet, I find their slogan, "We are the 99%, rather unsatisfactory. It reveals a lack of awareness about the wide range of antagonism existing in society and reveals a rather naive belief in the possibility of installing a consensual society once the bad 1% will have been eliminated. This kind of reasoning can too easily lead to a moralistic condemnation of the rich instead of a political analysis of the complex configuration of power forces that need to be challenged in order to create a more democratic society. And in addition to being too inclusive, I think that this slogan also seems to take for granted the pre-given unity of the we, and it obviates the necessary process of constructing this we through the articulation of a chain of equivalence among the manifold protests. And this is, I contend, you know, this construction of the we, the articulation, the construction of a chain of equivalence. This is the crucial political step without which no adequate political strategy can be designed. It has also been argued, and I think that, you know, it's worth considering this criticism, that the absence of a real political strategy among the movement calling for a consensual, real democracy indicate that they are still envisaging politics under a liberal framework, impeding them apprehending the nature of the political. This is a criticism which has been addressed by Jason Ickel when he argues that the shortcomings of Occupy and its incapacity to have any real impact in undermining neoliberal patterns of capitalist accumulation come from the fact that the assumption and subjectivities that organize liberalism continue to operate in the Occupy movement. Analyzing, for instance, the hallmark of the movement, it can bring to light the way they are informed by liberal ideology. He said that Occupy's structure of non-hierarchical, consensus-based, participatory democracy is taking the liberal ethic of celebrating diversity and tolerance to its extreme, and that this impedes them to apprehend the nature of power in capitalist societies and the fact of hegemony. Moreover, he sees an anti-political attitude and what he called the liberal ethic in full force in their refusal to organize around specific demand, so as not to alienate those who might disagree and in that way to discourage diversity. So I think that, you know, it's got a real point there, Ickel, and it's a criticism which I think is worth examining. And of course, we can find another point of conversion between those movements and the liberal approach in their demonizing of the state, which is of course a central feature of the neoliberal zeitgeist. In their repeated attempts to dismantle the institution created by the social democratic welfare state, neoliberal advocates have repeatedly employed a virulent anti-state rhetoric, denigrating everything related to the state as intrinsically authoritarian, when not totalitarian, and inimical to the liberty of the individual. By mobilizing a binary rhetoric celebrating the virtue of the free market against the oppressive state, those neoliberals have been able to justify the primacy of the market and the commodification of all social realms, thereby establishing the basis of neoliberal hegemony. Well, I'm concerned by the fact that such a negative attitude with respect to the state is also found in some left radical sectors. I think that such a convergence can be explained by a shared belief in the availability of a self-regulating society beyond division and beyond hegemony. Of course, such a society is envisaged differently by neoliberals and by the radicals. While the former, the neoliberals, deny the reality of existing power relations, the latter announce the coming of a society where power would have disappeared. So it's not yet, but it could exist. Nonetheless, I think that we find in both versions is a common refusal of the political in its antagonistic dimension and the constitutive role of power. So I think that it's really worth examining the point of convergence between those movements and liberal or neoliberal zeitgeist. The horizontalist protests also partake, of course, of the anti-state neoliberal rhetoric. They celebrate the common, not the market, but their rejection of the public and all the institutions linked to the state display uncanny similarities with the neoliberal attitude. They insist on seeing the state as a monolithic entity instead of a complex set of relations, dynamic and traversed by contradiction, precludes them from recognizing the multiple possibilities for struggling against the commodification of society that the fact of controlling state institutions could offer. The state is also can be an ally in the struggle against neoliberalism. So this is why I find that very worrying, this anti-state attitude in this kind of radical politics. So what I want to do now is to propose another reading of those protest movements, not as something which is fundamentally anti-representative and that brings the idea of a completely form of democracy, but something that goes against really existing representative institutions, not representative institutions per se. And of course, my interpretation of those protests is informed by my agonistic approach, and particularly by the way it is elaborated in my book On the Political. Because in that book, I criticize the current I call post-political trend, and affirm that we are, and that was a book, in fact it came out in 2005, so it was definitively before all those movements. I affirm that we are witnessing a crisis of representation as a consequence of the consensus at the center that has come to dominate politics in most liberal democratic societies. Now, the famous third way radical center, of course, theorized by Anthony Giddens for Tony Blair. No? But that was born in Britain and then spread all over Europe. Well, this consensus at the center, the fact that between center right and center left, there is basically no difference, is, of course, the result of the unchallenged hegemony of neoliberalism. Now, the fact that everybody now accepts what, you know, Margaret Thatcher used to say, there is no alternative. I mean, most social democratic and liberal parties know have accepted that. And that, of course, you know, what I call the consensus at the center. And this, of course, deprives democratic citizens of an agonistic debate where they can make their voice heard and choose between real alternatives. Agonistic debate means that it's a debate between really different alternatives, you know, in which people can choose, really. They can make a decision. Because if there's no fundamental difference between center-right and center-left, people really have no possibility to choose. Well, it's interesting that, and in fact, this is clearly the what I was examining in on the political, that so far the resistances against this consensus at the center, they had been manifested really or expressed by right-wing populist parties, no? Because that was the way in which people were able to vent their anger against the post-political situation. Well, things fortunately have changed recently, because with the recent protest, we are seeing the emergence of other ways much more estimable of reacting against the democratic deficit that characterize our post-democratic societies. But I want to argue that in both cases, what is at stake is a profound disaffection with the current order. If so many people, not only among the youth, but across the whole population, are now taking to the street, it is because they have lost faith in traditional parties and that they feel that their voice cannot be heard through traditional political channels. That's one of the motto of the protesters' claims. They say, we have a vote, but we don't have a voice. And I think that's exactly the case. You know, you can vote, but you know, doesn't more of the same. So they don't really have a voice. And this is what is at stake in what the crisis of representation, which is linked to the post-political situation. Understood as refusal of the post-political order, current protests can be read as a call for radicalization of existing democratic institutions, and not for their rejection. What they exact are better, more inclusive form of representation. To satisfy their demand for voice, existing representative institutions have to be profoundly transformed and new ones need to be established, so as to create the condition for a real agonistic confrontation where the citizen will be offered a choice between real alternatives. Of course, such a confrontation requires the emergence of a genuine left, not more of a center left, a genuine left able to offer an alternative to the social liberal consensus which is dominant in center left parties. And here, I mean, we've got some you know, positive sign, because I think the case of Greece is an interesting illustration of such an approach. There, the popular mobilization, as you know, are currently led by Syriza, a coalition of several left parties whose objective is to come to power through election to implement a set of radical reform. And we, of course, had the pleasure and yesterday of having Alexis Tsipras, you know, the leader of Syriza, coming and speaking about his party and his project. But it's clear that the aim of Syriza is not the demise of liberal democratic institutions, but their transformation to make them a vehicle for the expression of popular demand. So I think that the fact that this movement exists and the fact that, you know, it almost came to power in the last election and it's not at all unthinkable that it could win the next election, it's really something, you know, that is extremely important. If that is going to happen, that's going to change a lot, the whole panorama of the politics in Europe, I would think. And it must also, I think, I also see some good signs, some you know, positive thing in France. Because they are also very interesting element for reflection. It has, for instance, been noted that in contrast to many other European countries, the Occupy movement was almost insignificant in France. Some people have tried to explain that supposed anomaly by the fact that the austerity measure had not been as drastic in France as in other countries, that the level of unemployment was not so high, and so and so. But in that case, then why did several Occupy camps happen in Germany, where in fact the economic situation are better, even better than in France? I think that to look for economic explanation is really to miss the deep cause, which are of political nature. I'm of course not suggesting, I mean, please, don't read me saying that the French do not have serious ground for protest. But most of them seem to believe that significant political channels are still available to express their demands. No doubt, a consensus at the center between center-right and center-left has also been installed in France. But the belief in the power of politics to change things has not been waning there like in other European countries. And I think that is due to the existence on the left of the Socialist Party of several groups with a more radical agenda. And I think that the capacity, for instance, of Jean-Luc Mélenchon, the candidate of the Front de Gauche, a coalition of several left parties, to mobilize the youth in the 2012 presidential election was really remarkable. Many young people, I think, who in other countries would have fought in occupied camps, a form of expressing the protest, or simply would have remained skeptical against political involvement, felt that there was a space for their demand in the program of the Front de Gauche, and they participated with great enthusiasm in Mélenchon's campaign for a citizen revolution. So we really see, of course, the Front de Gauche is not yet far from being as important as Syriza, but it is the embryo of something similar. They've got the same kind of strategy, and I think that this is definitively the way to follow. Mélenchon and Alexis Tsipras, the leader of Syriza, we met him, as I was saying, yesterday, are often accused of being populist. Well, I think that far from being a ground for critique, this should be seen as a virtue. I think that there is a necessary populist dimension in democratic politics. If by populism we understand the construction of a people, of a collective will, to use Gramsci's term, well, it's clear that this is a necessary dimension of democratic politics, that the aim of a left popular movement should be to mobilize passion towards the construction of a people, of a progressive collective will. Of course, one say that, it's clear that a people, a collective will, a demos, can be constructed in many different ways, and some of them are incompatible with the left-wing project. It depends on the way the adversary is going to be defined. It's clear, for instance, that to construct a we need to determine with the they. And the crucial point is the identity of the we is also going to depend on the way the they is defined. Where right-wing populism defines the adversary in terms of the immigrant, the Muslim, so we've got the we of the people, which is defined by the people who are threatening the existence. And of course, here it's very interesting to compare the discourse of Marine Le Pen and Jean-Luc Mélenchon, because she constructs both are populist, but we've got on one side a populist of the right and populist of the left. In the case of Marine Le Pen, she constructs clearly, the immigrants, particularly the Muslim, now are, the day. For Mélenchon, it's completely different. It's much more those people are part of the we. And, of course, the day is, the financial system, the all the things which are the basis of that sustain neoliberal hegemony. So as you can see, that creates a very different situation. You know, it's both populism, yes, but a populism of the left, which is really a progressive form of populism, against a populism of the right. So the question is not about, you know, populist or not populist. It's about, you know, what kind of populism. So this is definitely something which I think Syriza is also, of course, accused of being populist. And as we know, people in South America who have been trying to, struggle against neoliberal hegemony, like Chavez and Correa and Cristina Kirchner, they are all accused of being populist. But, you know, this is a very important element, is to re-establish the centrality of the democratic dimension, the centrality of the popular sovereignty. So it's certainly something which is important for envisaging a radical strategy. Well, now I want to come to a last point, which is a kind of more theoretical, about this question of representation. You know, why I think that this strategy of anti-representation is really a dead end. Because at the center of the dispute about how to interpret the recent protests, what lies is in fact a very old discussion about the nature of democracy and the role of representation. Two positions confront each other. One sees representative democracy as an oxymoron, no? And argues that a real democracy can't be representative. It needs to be direct or even, now as we've seen, a presentist one. Another claim that far from being in contradiction to democracy, representation is one of its very conditions. Another position which I held. This is an issue that I have examined in previous work, and I think it might, in order to see, you know, in which way it is useful for the present situation, I want to quickly revisit some of the arguments of this discussion. In my book, The Democratic Paradox, I've argued that Western liberal democracy is the articulation of two traditions. Liberalism, which is emphasis on liberty, pluralism, rule of law, separation of power, and democracy. So two different traditions. Democracy, which postulates equality and popular sovereignty. While both of those traditions have important strength, I mean, they are ultimately irreconcilable. Perfect liberty cannot coincide with perfect equality. There is always, you know, one of the values which is the dominant one. And the history of liberal democracy has in fact been driven by the tension between the claim for liberty and those for equality. What has happened under neoliberal hegemony is that the liberal component has become so dominant that the democratic value have really been emasculated. Several previous democratic advances have been dismantled, and under the motto of modernization, core democratic values have been dismissed as archaic. Without underestimating the democratic shortcomings of social democracy, it is clear that the situation is drastically worsened under neoliberal hegemony. The democratic value of equality have been set aside, conveniently replaced by choice in the discourse of the third way and its social liberal avatar. And I think it's really regrettable that so many parties of the center-left are ready to accommodate themselves to what is rightly being qualified as a post-democratic condition. So we today live in a situation in which really, you know, it is the liberal component of liberal democracy, which has become more than hegemonic. It has almost displaced the other. And this is, of course, why some people believe that they identify so much democracy, you know, with this post-democratic state, that they say, well, we need to abandon this form of representative institution. We need a completely different form of democracy. They believe that they are in fact, within this articulation, liberalism and democracy, no possibility of a profound transformation. Well, I disagree with that. I believe that they are alternatives within the existing model, and that we should not accept the current situation as the final way of articulating liberalism and democracy. The experience of progressive government in South America in the last decade proves that it is possible to challenge neoliberalism and to re-establish the priority of democratic values without relinquishing liberal representative institutions. And it also showed that the state, far from being an obstacle to democratic advances, can in fact be an important vehicle for fostering popular demand. I mean, the role of the state in progressive government in South America has been extremely important. I think that's something we can really learn from. You know, we should not go on demonizing the state as seeing the enemy to be destroyed, but we need to transform it. So it seems to me that the recent, I want to call that the citizen awakening in Europe and in the US is of course very encouraging, because it breaks with the post-political consensus. A taboo has been broken, and many voices are now being heard contesting the inequalities existing in our societies. To effectively challenge neoliberal hegemony, though, it is crucial that all the energy that have erupted are not diverted towards wrong allies. And I'm afraid that it is what will happen if representative institutions become the main target of the protest. There is no denying that representative institutions are today in crisis, but they are in crisis in their current liberal democratic form. But I do not believe that the solution resides in the establishment of a non-representative democracy, or that extra-parliamentary struggles are the only vehicle for making democratic advances. You know, that's the position of the Exodus approach. Of course, such views are popular because they chime with the idea, which is very fashionable among some sectors of the left, that the multitude could auto-organize itself, avoiding taking power and avoiding becoming state. But I find that to see such an anti-political approach among activists involved in the various Occupy movement of the outrage, I find that really worrying, because it prevents designing an adequate strategy for their struggle. When representation is seen as the problem, the aim cannot be to engage with current institutions to make them more representative and more accountable, but then to simply discard them entirely. The objective of the movement will therefore be visualized in terms of an exodus from the given form of democracy on the ground that attempting to transform existing institutions is vain and that representative democracy is to be relinquished. This is the position clearly, you know, defended by Isabelle Laurie, which I quoted earlier. Many among those who reject representation identify, of course, representative democracy with its current post-democratic form and with the actual working of the parliamentary system. They do not see that the problem concerns the way representative institutions function at the moment, and the fact that so many of the voices that should be presented are excluded from representation. What needs to be challenged is the lack of alternative offered to the citizen, not the very idea of representation. A pluralist democratic society cannot exist without representation. To begin with, as the anti-essentialist approach is made clear, identities are never already given. They are always constructed. produced through discursive articulation. And this process of construction is a process of representation. It is through representation that collective political subjects are created, and they do not exist beforehand. Every assertion of a political identity is thereby interior, no exterior, to the process of representation. So that is a very, you know, theoretical, philosophical point, but I think it's crucial to see that there is no politics without representation. Secondly, in a democratic society where pluralism is not envisaged in the harmonious anti-political form and where the ever-present possibility of antagonism is taken into account, representative institutions, by giving form to the division of society, play a crucial role in allowing for the institutionalization of this conflictual dimension. However, such a role can only be fulfilled through the availability of an agonistic confrontation. What constitutes the central problem with our current post-political model is the absence of such an agonistic confrontation. And this is not going to be remedied through horizontalist practices. This is not to say, and I also want to insist on that because, you know, I don't want you to go with the idea that I think that radical politics should only be done through the institutional channels and through parliamentary form. I believe that those practices, horizontalist, presentist, do have a role to play in an agonistic democracy. I'm convinced, for instance, that the variety of extra-parliamentary struggle and the multiple form of activism are valuable, not only to raise consciousness, I think it's of course a very important thing, but also to bring to the fore issues that are neglected, and also by providing a realm for the cultivation of different social relations. For instance, I think the type of activism provides the terrain where critical artistic practices, you know, can flourish. And I've been interested in that in my work. And for instance, I think that it's a very important dimension of an agonistic politics. So I think that all those practices can represent a significant dimension of a counter-hegemonic offensive. But what I'm arguing here is that those practices cannot provide a substitute for representative institutions, and that it is necessary to establish a synergy between those practices and more institutional form of struggle. If the protest movement refuses to establish alliances with traditional channels deemed as intrinsically impervious to democratic transformation, then I'm afraid the radical potential will be lost. Amazingly, some activists are still celebrating the horizontalist experience in Argentina in 2001, presenting them as the model to follow, without acknowledging the limit of such a strategy. They do not seem to realize that the democratic advances that have taken place there and also in other South American countries in the last 10 years have been made possible thanks to an articulation of extra-parliamentary and parliamentary struggle. I mean, in case of Argentina, you know, if it had been only for the movement of the piqueteros, you know, it's not clear what will happen because they managed to bring down the Delaware government, but then they didn't want to get involved, you know, in traditional politics. So when they were election, it was between two traditional, you know, Peronist candidates. Thanks God, I mean, that's kind of a miracle. Nestor Kirchner was almost a known one the election, and he turned out to be much more radical than people imagine. He called the piqueteros, he said, come and work with me. Of course, part of them said, no, we don't want to have anything, you know, to do with that. A part joined him, and in fact, many of the things which are happening today in Argentina, the late mayor, that is things which result from a synergy between the various popular mobilization and the government of Néstor Kirchner and then Cristina Kirchner. So this is, and we could see things, you know, similar in other South American countries. So really, there it's the way in which social movement and accepted to work with the state. Of course, you know, it's there are contradictions, you know, there are moment difficulties, so it's not, you know, all rosy, but it is the only way in which things can really be changed. And I think that those are experiences from which the European left can and must learn. And it is high time to stop romanticizing spontaneism and horizontalism. The call for democracy now being voiced in a variety of quarters can only produce lasting effect if the activists involved in those movements, instead of implementing a strategy of withdrawal, accept becoming part of a progressive collective will, engage in what, you know, Gramsci called a war of position to radicalize democratic institutions and to establish a new hegemony. Thank you.
Thank you for your talk. It's been most interesting and thought-provoking. And I'm sure that what you've been saying has raised many questions. So I suggest we open the floor for discussion. There is a question here. Okay.
Can you raise?
Yeah.
Thank you for a very important talk. I especially appreciate this kind of critique of certain romanticism of refusal of representation and refusal of the state. It is one of the most important things here and now to prevent this kind of tendency. However, I have one doubt concerning your analysis of the Occupy movement, and I would like to point out certain maybe friction, which for me begs for a certain clarification. The friction would be as follows: you said that this kind of unifying name of 99% and this kind of opposition, which was created against the banking systems, bankers, whatever. Was a kind of example of maybe dangerous slipping into certain moralization. Maybe it is so, and maybe it is also a kind of factor which prevents more sophisticated analysis and mapping of certain systemic tendencies or mechanisms, which should be questioned if we have to build any kind of critique of our certain predicament. But from the other point of view, this kind of naming is precisely an example of this kind of logic of hegemony, which enables to build extremely long chain of equivalence and maintain it for a longer time in very difficult circumstances. The question which stems for me here would be, where is the difference between this dangerous moralization and this indispensable antagonization, which is still needed to maintain this kind of longer chain of equivalence or alliance, and where is then this kind of so needed, always present in constructing political identities representation?
Well, I must say, I realize that. There is a lot of appeal in this slogan, we are the 99%, you know, it's very forceful. But first, I've been very careful. I say there is the danger, but I've not criticized, I've not said this is a moralization, this is no. I say it could easily, you know, so I see that by not really analyzing that in political way. Well, look, the 99%, so there is only one person, which is the other. And of course, people go say, okay, the very rich. The problem is not with the very rich. You know, the problem is with the system. So what need to be is not by eliminating the one person of very rich that things are going to be fantastic. So it's a lack of a serious analysis, you know, economic and all the forces that sustain all the, you know, nodal points of the neoliberal system. By saying the 99%, this is a bit too simplistic. And I'm not saying, because I've been very careful about that, and I've been engaged with discussion. In fact, I've written in the Occupy in New York. They have just a journal called Tidal, and I've been writing, you know, for it, and we've been having discussion about that. It's I'm not saying that they are doing that exactly, but it is the by posing the question in that way, it could easily slip into some kind of moral, because of course we need a dichotomization. That's one of my fundamental points to my work. But it should not be made in terms of the good and the bad. You see, this is the problem. And in fact, I've been criticizing also that when I, on the political, I analyzed the reaction to right-wing populism in Europe. You know, those are the fascists. A moral condemnation. I mean, moral condemnation is not what need to be done in politics. Politics, we need a political analysis. And my argument about the 99% is that constructed like that, there's a danger that, you know, but it in fact does not, it's not conducive to a real analysis of what are the forces that need to be addressed and deconstructed. That's the first point. And the other point is, and that I think is also extremely important, is that it tends to say, okay, we are 99%, but all the contradiction among the 99%, they don't insist on that. And I think that there is also this idea that we are already, you know, it's there. No, we need, there are many different people who participate in those movements are having very different aims. So if you really want, and that in fact is true, by the way, for also many other movements, because it's not enough to unite against an enemy. You also need to establish a question of equivalence, so that when people are going to come to you know, if when come and do government, then you are not going to have everybody wanting to do something different. You need to really construct political unity. And the slogan, we are the 99%, it's obfuscate this kind of analysis, I feel.
We only have time for one final question, unfortunately. So I see a hand over there. Just one brief final question, please.
What caught my attention when you mentioned the classical mobilization of students by the left, I think it was in the case of Chile. So I would like to hear who, in your view, is the agent of that mobilization? Is it Partido Comunista de Chile, or who are those agents of mobilization? And the sub-question would be, what is your view on this dissolution of parlamentarismo to the level of assemblismo, as you mentioned?
Excuse me, but I don't really understand the second question. Can you repeat what is the...
What is your view, like in this kind of proposal that is made of dissolution of parlamentarismo into assemblismo?
I think that my whole talk was the answer to that. That saying that I'm against this idea that we need to. The whole talk was a critique of that. You know, I'm not defending traditional parliamentarism. I mean, I'm saying we need those institutions, and we need basically to establish a connection, you know, a synergy between a parliamentary and extra-parliamentary struggle. What I am against is I'm against both the people who say no, we should only have politics through the traditional channels, you know, but I'm also against the people who say no, we don't should not go at all through the traditional channels. We should only go through assemblyism and extra-parliamentary struggle. My line is that we need to articulate those two types of struggle. With respect to Chile, no, I'm not saying at all that the movement is led by the Communist Party. In fact, the movement, in terms of the affiliation of the people at the movement, is very, very, very heterogeneous. In fact, Camila Vallejo, she lost when they were re-election for the leadership, she lost to somebody who is much more on the extra ultra-left than she is. So it's very, very, very varied. But what I'm saying is that, contrary to the indignados, the people who are, and of course, there are also in the movement people who are not involved in parties, but they don't have this idea that we should not be part of the party, because in the indignado there is a total rejection of first they don't want any a leader, and the movement had a leader, you know, Camila Vallejo, no, and those people who are involved, they don't see any problem in having people involved in politics, in parties, and they have no problem in engaging also with the representative system. You know, the example I was giving, that Camila Vallejo, no, is a candidate for the Communist Party to the for the next election. So it's simply to say that they've got a very different attitude from the indignados with respect to the role of the parties and the way in which, you know, politics should not be done only through mobilization, but also through more you know, traditional representative channels.
Thank you all for your interest and for your participation. Chantal, thank you once again for a most stimulating contribution to our conference. And I'm afraid we need to call it a day, at least for this session. Thank you.